Welcome back, everyone. This is the Hit Mix Show, Top Hits Classic Dance Tracks 10-11. The next guest is an amazing, young, talented young man, Charlie Chech. Well, he's a lover of jazz, plays the drums, also plays the piano, I believe. Age of 15 or 16, not sure about that. He sang with Michael Bublé in front of 22,000 people. What hasn't he done so far? Has been interviewed by so many people. ABC Today's Show. We also got Carl, of course, Carl on the Channel 9, the Today Show, and on and on and on. And of course, he plays so many gigs these days. He's just an amazing, talented young guy. Welcome to Alive 90.5, Charlie.
Oh, thank you so much, Dom, and thank you for having me today. It's a real pleasure to be here with you in the studio. Yeah, really exciting.
Want to take you right back. Right back.
Oh,
okay?
Yeah.
Okay? Tell me a little bit about yourself, of what you can remember.
Okay. I had a great childhood. I'm only 19. But, you know, I've got great parents and I had a great childhood. I grew up, you know, just down the road in Cherrybrook.
Local lad.
I've been a local boy to the hills all my life. And I went to Oakhill Drive Primary and, in year three and year four, I developed a real love for music. But I'd always heard music in the car as far early as I can remember, you know, it being played, you know, Prince and Michael Jackson and Dire Straits. And I think that really sort of informed me. Moving forward, and I developed a real affinity for the drums and rhythm, and so I joined, you know, junior stage band, and ever since then, going into high school, I developed a real passion for music, for jazz, you know, for tempo, and it's real struck a personal chord with me. So yeah, I've always been influenced by music, you know, growing up. Yeah, and I think it's impacted me a lot.
Now, you graduated class of prestigious talent development. So tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, it's a great program, state government run program, the Talent Development Project. It's a household name for a lot of, you know, up and coming artists, and you know, its list of graduates and alumni is vast and, you know, incredibly impressive. But there are a program that's been around for about 30 years that aims to train up-and-coming musos and performers in the state of New South Wales in public high schools to, you know, take that next step and to give them that industry training. It's headed up by the wonderful Peter Cousins, who is probably one of Australia's famous musical theatre exports. And, I was only about 16 when I started with the Talent Development Project, so I was a kid who didn't have much confidence. So they instilled, a lot of that stage presence and belief and, personal confidence in yourself, which is really important in this whole, you know, music caper. So it was, it was very noteworthy.
And how are you coping with all the fame at the moment? Because you're getting on to 7:30 and all these people, they all want a little bit about you, and they want a bit of you. So how are you coping with all that at this stage?
Yeah, I think I've learned to deal with it, but it's something that I never thought would happen. So it's going to take a while, I think, to get used to. But you know, there was Australian Idol, and then there was, you know, the 7:30 report on ABC, and then my interview on the Today Show, and you know, even 5 minutes or on that sort of morning breakfast is huge exposure. So I'm really grateful for all of it, and I've received, you know, a lot of love and support from those appearances, which is great. You know, people still tune into morning breakfast, but 7:30 was great because they came along to a gig of mine at Galston, a Christmas in July gig, and they actually captured the sentiment of keeping the Great American Songbook alive. So it's a lot of people who've, started following me, actually like this music, and, you know, they appreciate jazz and they appreciate the old crooners. So it's not just, you know, random people, but it's people who really love the style, which is great.
It virtually never goes out of style anyhow. So, but one thing I will say in regards to crooners, they can have a niche, but in the case of yourself, you've got a great voice. I really reckon you're in that niche, but get into a lot of the other artists, because I tell you now, I'm an Elvis freak. And let me tell you something.
Awesome.
I listen to your version, If I Can Dream.
Uh-huh.
Now, I'm a pretty big critic of Elvis impersonators and whatever, let me tell you.
Okay.
But in saying that, it's one of the better versions, which means it's going to be great for you to get involved with other artists in that type of form, because, you know, it puts you into another league. You know, when you can pick up Billy Joel or pick up an Elvis track 100%. And they just fall apart.
Yeah.
And that's, that. In my opinion, I'm just watching you on YouTube and all those tracks, and I thought you did it proud. So I said, well, you know, not too many people have done that, which is, and I'm pretty proud of that,
because
you've got
so
a great voice.
So
I just thought I'd tell you that. But look, a little bit about your new CD.
Yep.
Tell me a little bit. Before we do that, you've obviously got a lot of gigs now. You're at Hornsby RSL.
Yeah.
You're getting exposure. You're really doing a lot of work out there, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
You're really enjoying it?
I am. I've always loved performing live, even when I was performing with a high school big band.
Yeah.
I was used to being at the back of the band, and then all of a sudden I was at the front of the band.
Yeah.
So it's something that I got used to very quickly, and something that I love, you know, seeing the reactions of people, interacting with the audience. And I think it's something that I didn't think came naturally, but it does, which is you know,
that's
good
right.
to have. But yeah, all these gigs are just more experience, and I love it. I love being on the stage and different types of performances as well. You know, Hornsby's that big stage with a huge auditorium.
That's where Lisa Marie Presley went to. That's the only club she picked.
There you go. Well,
I was there that night.
Actually
spoke to her.
Nice.
To her.
How good.
The only thing is, I didn't have what your manager's got over there. Didn't have that camera.
Oh, no.
Unfortunately. But that's the way it goes. But I tell you what, she was fantastic. And she only picked a couple of places, and that was one of them.
Yeah,
so Hornsby RSL was
a
fantastic
great spot.
Place.
Good management, good sound system. You know, they treat their artists well.
Now, before we go into a little bit of the CD, I want to also ask you the experience of Michael Bublé. How did that come about?
Yeah, look, this was, I think, the unofficial launch of my career, the best way we can put it. You know, I was 15, I was turning 16 in about a month, and it was a month before COVID in 2020, right?
Right.
And I was a big, huge Michael Bublé fanatic. The guy's a freak.
Oh,
a freak of nature.
We like him.
And
my wife loves him.
You know, his voice is just totally unfathomable, right? And we got really great tickets. Mum and Dad got me great tickets for my birthday. And so we went along, and I saw that, you know, he's such a G-up, right? So he was getting folks up from the crowd to sing. So I made a poster, and he's a highly astute fellow. So we saw the poster.
Yeah.
And he's probably gone, all right. You know, this is going to be a real gamble. But
how's this going to be for me?
He made eye contact with me. He gestured for me to move forward. And I came up to him, and he said, look, what do you want to do? Let's do anything. Whatever you want. I said, what do you think in the shower? I'm like, all right. So I said, you're nobody till somebody loves you. And the adrenaline kicked in, and we did the duet in front of 20,000 people. And, you know, I don't know how I didn't faint or have some sort of medical episode, but we kept it up and we performed it, you know, relatively well. So that's going to stick with me for life. And he's a great guy too. You know, I've kept in contact with a number of people.
You can't,
in the band too. He's a great
exposure
guy.
Like that's fantastic.
Oh, totally. You know,
that would have, you know, blown you out a little bit into the system.
For sure. Yeah. It's done well on YouTube, which is, you know, it's been, pretty great.
Yeah. And I saw you did a show at the Lazy Bones.
I did. Yeah. This was the
great
launch.
Place.
Yeah, it's a great spot. I'd never performed there before, but this was the live launch of my debut EP, Checkmate. So this was the same guys, the same band that played on the tracks, were with me, and the band leader, Clive Lendich, who was also the composer and the producer and the sort of co-mastermind of the project. So it was great to have him with us as well. But we got a good crowd. You know, we were a couple of tickets off from selling it out, and it was a great night. You know, it was good vibes, it was a great atmosphere, it was very chilled and laid back, and people were getting into jazz.
Yeah.
Clapping along to, you know, tracks that have been around for almost 100 years is a great feeling.
Fantastic. Now, just before we go into one of your tracks, has your studies finished, or is this the new... The new Charlie, or is it sort of you're thinking about it?
Ongoing. Yeah, they're about halfway at this point. I'm halfway through a politics media degree at Macquarie.
Yeah.
I'm very much enjoying it. You know, it keeps me busy, and it keeps me grounded, but at the same time, it gives me something to do as well. I've always been very interested in learning and academics. You know, I had a pretty good experience at high school. I actually enjoyed year 11 and 12. You know, I had good teachers, and the HSE was difficult, but, you know, I'm really enjoying university as well. I've got, you know, good classes, very interesting. So it's good.
So how long to go for uni?
About a year and a half.
Okay.
Yeah, so not long.
That's fantastic, because you're still keeping that part of your life alive in case you really, you know, if you do become big,
yeah.
Forget it. I'll tell you something, you don't need uni.
Oh, thank you. Thanks
one,
so much.
One packed out 22,000, that's the end of it. You don't have to worry about education again. What we're going to do is play a track off your new CD, Checkmate.
Yep.
It's track number 3, awesome. New York State of Mind. This is Charlie Chech.
Some folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood, hop a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood. But I'm taking a greyhound on the Hudson River line, 'cause I'm in a New York state of mind. I've seen all the movie stars and their fancy cars and their limousines, been high in the Rockies under the evergreens. But I know what I'm needing, and I don't want to waste more time. I'm in a New York state of mind. It was so easy living day by day, out of touch with the rhythm and the blues. But now I need a little give and take, the New York time, the day. It comes down to reality, and it's fine with me, 'cause I've let it slide. Don't care if it's Chinatown or on the riverside. I don't have any reasons, left them all behind, 'cause I'm in a New York state of mind. With the rhythm and the blues. But now I need a little give and take, the New York Times, the Daily News. It comes down to reality, and it's fine with me, 'cause I've let it slide. Don't care if it's Chinatown or the riverside. I don't have any reasons, left them all behind, 'cause I'm in a New York state of mind.
just taking a greyhound on the Hudson River line. 'Cause I'm in a New York state of mind.
Five, the Hit Mix Show, Top Hits, Classic Dance Tracks, 1027. Charlie, are we back?
I think we are.
We are back. What a great, it's a great CD, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
It really is. Will you, I was going to mention to you in regards to Australian Idol. Tell me about that experience.
Yeah, well, you know, it all sort of just happened, again, like usual, really quickly. One sort of molded into another, but We saw that it was coming back and it had been off our screens for about 8 years or so. And so we thought we may as well give it a crack because, you know, we've got really nothing to lose. You know, any exposure is good exposure. So it was quite a daunting experience, to be completely frank, because it was then revealed that one of the judges was going to be Harry Connick Jr. So what do you do with that information? And that was a week before I did my, you know, pre-recorded audition at the ICC in Sydney. So I'd only just found out and I didn't have much time to prepare myself. But it was, you know, I think it was really informative to get that behind the scenes look at how these reality TV shows and reality scene TV shows are produced, and the strategies and the techniques that are employed, because, you know, it was something that I wasn't aware of at home watching it on my screen. It's a lot of smoke and mirrors, but, you know, it's very clean-cut produced. And I think that it gave me a lot of confidence. And, you know, if I could have dealt with that experience, I can sort of deal with anything moving forward, which is good to, you know, have that belief in myself moving forward. But, you know, I managed to make it to the top 50, which was, you know, a pretty good achievement because there were some phenomenal singers and performers in that group. And, you know, I got a, you know, tick of approval from Harry, which is, you know, great to add to the resume, along with singing with Bublé. So, I've sort of met and had dealings with both of them now, which is really unheard of for a 19-year-old kid. And, you know, he had some constructive criticism and feedback to give to me, but, you know, I think it's because he believes so much in the style and, you know, it means a lot to him. So it was a great experience to have and to add along to the rest of them, but I'm not sure if I'll be doing those TV shows again because they're pretty stressful.
Look, let me tell you, I interviewed Steve Clisby and, you know, he's been on it twice on one of those shows. Mm. But one thing you've got to remember about those shows, I do watch them for the sake because I love music, uh-huh. Right? But if you go back on when they've started in Australia, you could probably count 5 or 6 people that have made it from those shows.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which means what happens afterwards is pretty stressful, and a lot of things happen that
you've got to deal with the consequences.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
aren't very good. So, but if you have a look at the best artists in the world, you know, most of them were nothing.
No, self-made.
And it's self-made.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, like whether you like Justin Bieber or you don't, he was out of TikTok.
Yeah.
And he was out of just putting himself, like, so a lot of that stuff. When you think about it, it's great to be on it because you get people see your face.
Mm.
But what it's all about is your talent.
That's
your
it.
Voice.
Yeah.
But it's great to have that happening.
Yeah, know? I think so.
Now, this CD, which I do love, Checkmate, tell me about all the musicians in it and how it all came about.
Great musicians, and a real honour to work with, you know, this sort of calibre of musicians. You know, for some years now, I'd obviously been studying the Great American Songbook and soaking up all of this, you know, knowledge and musicality from, you know, so many great artists. But I was getting a lot of feedback at the gig saying, where's your CD? Where's your CD? We want to purchase something, which was obviously, you know, a great honor to hear. And so we went away, and it was a long process, probably about 8 to 10 months to, you know, pre-produce such a thing, an EP with five tracks. But, you know, Clive Lendich was very influential to the whole project, and I knew I wanted to produce a five-track EP. I needed to find the right person to do it with, and someone who had that belief in me. So I met Clive at a gig last year, and, you know, he's very much renowned in the industry. He's worked with some huge names, Hugh Jackman, and so forth. So I called him up, and he was very keen. So we went into pre-production. The first task was choosing the songs. So we had a consensus between the two of us. We didn't want to repurpose what had already been done at all, because, you know, that's just been done by hundreds and hundreds of artists before. It's not a bad thing, but we wanted to add something fresh and novel to it all. So we chose our favorite standards, Summer Wind and Almost Like Being in Love. We contemporized them, but we also looked back at, you know, some vintage pop standards of the 70s and 80s. And, you know, so what has the most classic riff? You know, what has the most musicality? And it was New York State of Mind that was we agreed on in an instant, because we both loved the song, but also Your Latest Trick, you know, by Dire Straits. And this was something that when I mentioned to Clive, it was, oh, yeah, you know, I haven't heard that song in about 20 years. There's a lot of, you know, a lot to work with. So we're really proud of the end product. It, you know, all came together really quickly. We went into Studio 301, which is undoubtedly the best studio in Australia and up there in the world, you know, in the top 10, you know, great facilities. And we tracked the band on the first day and the rhythm section, and we got some, you know, Graham Jesse on saxophone, that unmistakable sound, Dave Pritchard-Blunt on the keyboard, as you just heard on New York State of Mind. Mind you, he went out for about 10 minutes longer on that outro, just you know, straight going. Unfortunately, that had to be cut. But yeah, we had a lot of fun with it, and we did the vocals on the second day, and Clive went away and he mixed, mastered the tracks in about a month, and, you know, it's available to stream on all streaming services. We dropped it live on the 29th of September, so about a month and a bit ago now, and it's done quite well. It's racked up about 15,000 streams on Spotify alone, and the fifth track, Speak Softly Love, has 10,000 streams alone. So we're really proud of how it's done, how it's been received. I think people have really enjoyed it, and, you know, we've also got a physical copy for those who still, you know, use that, you know, so CD important. Players. 100%.
Look, yeah. You know, this is what I can't believe that if artists really want to be something, they should be able to give you a something and touch it and feel it.
I think so. Yeah.
And
it's,
you
a
know,
social
like,
contract of sorts. You know?
So you go to Spotify. Yeah. Well, you can't even. You know, you're not allowed to download that stuff.
Well, no, you can't. Not to your desktop.
So,
you know.
So
you've
the
got a
thing
physical
is,
copy. You can play as much as you want.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So I'm pretty stubborn on that. I say, well, look, you know, put the effort in and get yourself a CD or put it out, because that way I can play it any time and any show. And
exactly.
You know, and like I said, if you've got to download and things like that, you've got to watch everything you do these days when you're in a radio.
And, you know, it wasn't
they'll pick you
difficult
up and,
to do, mind you. It was just, you know, there's only a handful of folks that produce, mass-produce CDs and CD covers and design them in Australia.
Yeah.
So it's not hard to track down the folks who were left to do it.
Yeah.
And they were great people who we dealt with, and we got them shipped from Melbourne to Sydney in a couple of weeks, and we had them sold as an off-the-market exclusive at my Hornsby show in May, which was great. And we, you know, we sold about 100 physical copies.
Yeah.
And we had about 300 in the audience. So, you know, about a third of the room went away with a CD, which was great.
Now,
so,
it takes a while to be invited to sing a national anthem. Tell me about that.
Yeah.
I just found out about that from your manager over there, which is fantastic. Thank you for telling me, Annette.
It was such a great gig. We've done, you know, a lot of anthems over the past year or so, but this was extra special. On Saturday, we got invited to sing the national anthem at the Golden Eagle Derby at Rose Hill, and this was a huge race, you know.
Yeah.
There were a lot of A-listers
sure
there. So, you know, it's different to the crooning, and it's different to the shows, where it's you know, it's a great honour and quite prestigious to be performing the national anthem at these events. And you know, I'm very thankful for, you know, living and being born in a country such as Australia. So it's a different element to that performing, but it was packed. There were probably about, you know, 10,000 people there. You know, the stands were all full and everyone's singing with you. It's a really prideful sort of experience. So, yeah, that was great as well.
And have you lived in this area most of your life, or?
Yeah, I have.
Local guy and just...
Oh, yeah. Just you know, I haven't been moving around much. I've been in Cherrybrook for 19 years. And, you know, I love it. I was very involved in the local community in Cherrybrook Tech. You know, it was a great school that I think informed, you know, a lot of my character moving forward. And it's a great area as well. A lot of the people that attend my shows are locals, and they're really keen to...
So what about your old school? Do you go back there and say hello to them?
You know, sometimes I do, just because I had such a great relationship with my teachers. And, you know, a lot of these teachers still attend my shows. So I've got a lot of respect and gratitude to my teachers and also my school for believing me and putting me forward for programs like such as the TDP, because, you know, it really meant a lot to my career. But it's a strange feeling going back, especially to primary school, to an area, you know, where you spent 6-7 years of your life at primary school and then high school, and the equipment is so small.
Yeah.
And you're so big now, and you can't fathom, you know, you attending that school for 7 years straight, and then all of a sudden you're off. You know, it's such an anticlimactic experience. Yeah. You know, well, you finish your HSC now you're off into the world. But yeah,
got involved with one of those magic speeches we're going to have Charlie back to say our few words? Have they got into that yet?
I don't think I've hit it big time just as yet, just because CCHS has this huge alumni base, and when you sit down at these Year 12 assemblies and you get, you know, these huge names that come to deliver the speeches, we had, you know, we've got Olympians, we've had, you know, people that have gone over to compete in international football, but also actors, you know, A-list actors. I'm forgetting his name now.
Jai Courtney,
that's the guy. You know, it's hard to compete with Jai Courtney, but, you know, maybe one day I'll be asked back. I think that's when you've really hit it big time, when you get asked back by your high school to give a speech, and made it.
They put your arm around it. He's always my mate. He was a great kid.
You'll get claimed by the mob. Yeah, the teachers that have stuck around for about 35 years, you know, I knew this guy when. Yeah.
What we're going to do, we're going to play that track that I want to listen to, actually, your latest trick, the one that you think that from the Dire Straits. Mm-hmm. And then we're going to ask you one last question.
Okay.
And I don't know if you watch my interviews, but there's one question I ask at the end every time.
Good.
And I will be doing that. Nice. But let's have another track of Checkmate, and of course your latest trick.
Between the satin bowls and their bells, prehistoric garbage trucks have the city to themselves. Echoes and roars and dinosaurs, they're all doing the monster mash. Most of the taxis and most of the halls are only taking calls for cash. I don't know how it happened, it all took place so quick, but all I can do is hand it to you and your latest trick. Security was laid back in lax, but it was only my heart that got broken. You must have had a passkey made out of wax. You played a robbery with insolence, and I played the blues and 12 bars down a lover's lane. And you never did have the intelligence to use the 12 keys hanging off from my chain. I don't know how it happened, it all took place so quick. But all I can do is hand it to you and your latest. For alcohol, past the recall has been here and gone. The landlord, he finally paid us all. The satin jazz men have put away their horns. And now we're standing outside of this wonderland, looking sober, even sober as, like a Bowery bum when he finally understands the bottle's empty and there's nothing left. Whoa, I don't know how it happened, it was faster than the eye could flick. But all I can do is hand it to you and your latest
I'm 90.5, 1043. We're back with Charlie. How are you, Charlie?
Pretty good.
Good.
Great to hear that on radio. It's a really surreal feeling.
Okay, here's the question. Now, I ask everybody, and it'll be interesting. And you, just whatever you feel, all
okay.
right? And it can be whatever you decide.
No right or wrong answer.
No right or wrong.
Okay.
But if you were sitting on a bench, uh-huh. looking at a beautiful sea or a nice forest, and you're sitting back de-stressing, and I said to you, you've got an hour to talk to anybody dead or alive.
Whoa.
Who would it be?
Oh, see, I could take the obvious choice and say Frank Sinatra, but I'm not going to say Frank Sinatra because I'm actually a huge history buff and I did modern, ancient and extension history in high school. So I think if I had to choose out of anyone on the,
dead
on the
or
timeline,
alive?
I'd choose Alexander the Great. 100%.
And why?
I don't think, again, this is just my nerdy geeking out, but I don't think any single individual has had such an impact on the historical timeline moving forward. And I want to know the mysteries. I want to know what happened in the Egyptian Delphi. You know, I want to know it all. And I think, you know, Sinatra and Dean Martin, a lot of it's recorded, right, and documented. So I can just listen to, you know, cuts and, you know, conversations of them speaking in a restaurant on YouTube, but you know, Alexander the Great and a lot of these guys in history, and it's a lot of it's just on clay tablets. So that's my final choice.
And you know, it's true because a lot of those people did change history.
Exactly.
Now there's people in music, as you know, that have done that too.
Yeah.
You know, like whether you hated him, you liked him.
Yeah.
The king changed history. And you know, I'll tell 100%. You, I'm going to say one thing, because I'm a bit of a freak though. I'm going to tell you that.
Uh-huh.
Everybody says he was the king of rock and roll. That is completely, utterly wrong.
Yeah, I've always.
He was the king of the whole of music, because
yeah.
he had number ones in every genre,
yeah,
except classical, of course.
Oh.
Right? So you tell me anybody else that had number ones in every genre of music.
Yeah.
So I don't believe he's the king of rock and roll.
There
I believe
go.
He's the king of music.
Yeah.
So there you go. So look, thank you very much, and I want to appreciate your time for here today that
no,
you had with me.
Thank you so
really,
much.
Really, really good.
On,
and it's great to have met Annette over there too. She's doing all the hard work in the background.
Oh yeah.
Very proud of you.
I'd be lost without her. She, a lot of, you know, the effort and the time that she puts in is not seen. So I appreciate her immensely and everything she does, and she's just the best. So, yeah, three cheers for Annette.
Well done, Annette. Okay, this is track number 5 from his Checkmate album. Now, over the next 2 or 3 weeks, we're going to be giving away CDs. And what I'll do, we'll open the lines and we'll just ask someone that might want a CD, and I'm sure that people will come up over the next 3 or 4 weeks and we'll give them away from Charlie, that's left me about 6 copies. Oh, and your music is going to...
Ring the lines, folks.
Because they cost a fair bit of money.
Overcrowd the lines.
Yeah, and you'll get yourself 1 free CD, Charlie Chet's new CD, Checkmate.
How good.
Thank you very much, Charlie,
Thank you, John.
Great to have you on board.
It was wonderful. Thanks so much.
Blowing in from across the sea, it lingered there to touch your hair and walk with me. All summer long we sang that song, and then we strolled down that golden sand. Two sweethearts and the summer wind, like painted kites, those days and nights they went flying by. The world was new beneath that blue umbrella sky. And then softer than a piper man, what it called to you, I lost you. The summer wind, the autumn winds and the winter winds, they have come and gone. But still those days, those lonely days, they go on and on. And guess who sighs his lullabies through nights that never end? My fickle friend, that summer wind. Never end, my fickle friend, that summer wind, the summer wind, yeah, the summer wind.
You're tuned in to Dominic Vozzo and the Hit Mix program on Alive 90.5.